Radnor Township. Tonight we have one thing on our agenda. That's a presentation of the possible amendments to the Plan Institutional Zoning District. It's a single presentation. We are going to turn it over to Kevin from the township to go ahead and take it from here. Kevin, go right ahead.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. As you noted, we are here tonight to discuss the research that Urban Research and Development Corporation has done so far in anticipation of amending the Planned Institutional Zoning District ordinance. I just wanted to let everybody know that we are not going to discuss specifics regarding the Villanova proposal. There is a petition filed. It is available on the website. That is going to be discussed specifically at the June 18th Board of Commissioners meeting to the specifics of that parcel. So tonight is more the research that Charlie has done to date on general institutional zoning issues. So I'll turn it over to Charlie.
Thank you. I'm Charlie Schmale from Urban Research and Development Corporation. By the way, I believe everybody knows we're on live television, I believe. So watch your language. We are community planning consultants that work with a lot of different municipalities. We were asked to work with Radnor Township on updating the institutional zoning of provisions of the township. Villanova is part of that, but it certainly is only one piece of it. As we'll get to in a second, it affects many other sites. It is not our responsibility to make policy decisions. We follow the policy direction of the Board of Commissioners and the Planning Commission. It is our job to talk to you about alternatives, to illuminate the impacts of some of those alternatives, and to find ways to carry out policies established by the township. So the township tells us what end result you're looking for, and it's our job working with the township staff to help you find the best way to get to that result. Let's see, the page down button. Is there a excuse me?
Down arrow key.
Down the arrow key, okay. There, I was looking for the page down button. Here's a list of all the institutions that are currently in the PI, Plan Institutional District. Radnor has dealt with this issue differently for instance, Lower Merion. Lower Merion allows institutional uses throughout the whole township, but they require special exception approval. Radnor sets boundaries for the institutions within an institutional district, but typically does not require Zoning Hearing Board approval for each individual use in that district. So one sets geographic area, the other has more of a process for each individual approval. We believe that there's always room for compromise, there's always room for balance, that everybody has legitimate concerns that need to be addressed, and the process here that is involved is to listen to those concerns and find solutions that are in everyone's best interests. We recognize institutions need to adapt. They need to improve their facilities over time. And we believe that can occur in a way that protects the residential neighborhoods and avoids traffic problems. And we've dealt with this issues in many, many municipalities in Reading and Allentown and Scranton and Williamsport and Carlisle. In many, many other communities, we've dealt with these exact same issues. The township last year adopted some restrictive zoning for housing of students that is off of a campus. It's called student home zoning. Students are limited to 2 college students, has to be in a single family home, and has to be 1,000 feet from another student home, and it needs to be approved by the Zoning Hearing Board. So that's a strict set of regulations. Lower Merion, for instance, allows 3 students to live in a student home, and most communities don't regulate this matter at all. I simply mention this as a policy the township has adopted that you're trying to limit off-campus housing. That the township has felt that's a problem, and you didn't want intrusion of student homes into the regular residential neighborhoods. The goal was to push more of the student housing onto the campuses. If you want to have 3 or more students living in a housing unit, or you want to have a dormitory or fraternity or sorority, The only place you can do that is the institutional district. And we've noted that some other communities, they've regulated the number of unrelated persons or number of unrelated students differently from place to place. In Allentown, for instance, it's permitted to have more students in an apartment complex than it is to have in a single-family detached house, because they feel that's a different character, a different density is expected. I mean, the students have to be somewhere, and part of this process is where the students should be. All the larger private schools, all the colleges are all in the PI district right now. The one exception is that the older buildings that have offices of Villanova on the western part of the south side of Lancaster Avenue is in an office district, and the schools are in another district, the public schools. I guess that's a storm. Is that a storm? There's some logic in the current zoning that's in place. The goal is to take the uses that have the greater impacts upon houses and have a larger setback for them from the residential districts, and the uses that have less impact upon the houses to have a smaller setback from the residential districts. So the current zoning says that the student housing, the food services, parking structures, parking decks, athletic facilities, recreation facilities, maintenance facilities, utility facilities, things that generate noise or typically have more truck activity, all those things have to be 200 feet from a residential district. And that some of the less intense uses, like faculty offices, surface parking lots, classroom buildings, can be 125 feet away from the residential district. And one of the things we want to look at is looking what the right distance is and what uses can be refined a little better to make this distinction. There is a requirement that 55% has to be landscaped, and there is a traffic study required every time that they submit a land development plan, which is pretty much any new building of an institution has to have a traffic study. In the case of the Villanova proposal before you, I would ask that a traffic study come in before the zoning change, but they would have to have a traffic study in the future when they come in with more detailed plans. And that traffic study has to also address pedestrians and bicyclists. The township has a current requirement that there must be a 10-year plan for the whole campus, and it has to be updated, and then has to address impacts. So what often happens in major institutions is they only show you one little thing at a time, and you never know what the next project is, and they always say, well, we don't have any other plans. The township has been trying to deal with that and say, we want a long-term plan. We want to see how it's all going to fit together, because we know you have it. You have to show it to us. This is the project that has been offered before a meeting in March before the Board of Commissioners. We're not really here to get into the details of this tonight, but I wanted to highlight just a couple things because they are the biggest institutional issue before the township. The proposal is 3 to 5-story buildings, taking 1,160 students out of the neighborhoods and moving them to the existing parking lot site, south side of Lancaster Avenue, moving the bookstore, adding some dining and other commercial and retail uses to the site, putting a 6-story parking deck that would replace the existing parking that's being replaced, that's being lost, and then adding a performing arts center. And all of this is on the Villanova website if anybody hasn't seen it yet, and all this information is there. Some of the comments that have been made at the public meetings that you've heard is a goal of reducing daytime traffic because more of the students will be closer to the classroom buildings during the day within walking distance. The idea of having smaller building setbacks from Lancaster Avenue, that is something that the township has been encouraging in other parts of Lancaster Avenue, is having buildings closer to Lancaster Avenue. A couple things that immediately caught our eye, whether these commercial uses would be better placed to remain on the central campus, the main campus. I can imagine a scenario where they replace the bookstore with a much larger building That's been called the ugliest building on Villanova's campus, the bookstore. Particularly because we're concerned about the proposal for a new parking and access right off of Lancaster Avenue, which seemed a little problematic as far as traffic flow. And is this the right location for five-story buildings? Now, most of the buildings wouldn't be five-story, but some are proposed. And many, many comments have been received about pedestrian traffic across Lancaster Avenue. The only institution that has that issue is Villanova, of all the institutions in the township. And when you look at other similar universities, they have typically built pedestrian overpasses. I can name multiple ones, the most closest ones being St. Joe's, right on City Line Avenue. It was a very similar situation. We included a photo of that one. University of Delaware, University of Virginia, there's University of Pennsylvania. Many, many of them have built pedestrian overpasses over similar highways in similar situations. It's not only a safety issue, but as was mentioned at the public meetings, it's a traffic congestion issue because there's it greatly slows down the traffic to wait for all those students to pass. A bridge works best when it's integrated into a building. So you can imagine a scenario where if that parking deck is built, the elevators and stairwells of that parking deck could serve one side of a pedestrian overpass, and maybe an extension onto the field house could serve the other half of that overpass, or an extension on the business school. There's lots of ways to do it. But as you see at St. Joe's, it works best when you have elevator access on both sides, because if you make it too hard for people to go up steps, they won't do it. They'll just run across the road. And you have to be very concerned about Americans with Disabilities Act access, so you really need the elevators. Cabrini College, they have a proposal right now that's been offered to the township to build a new parking structure along Eagle Road, 120 feet away from Eagle Road. Their goal, as many colleges, is to intercept much of their traffic and much of their parking towards the edge of the campus and try to keep their campus as pedestrian-friendly as possible and as bicycle-friendly as possible. Again, there's few residential neighborhoods in this immediate area, and Cabrini is very well buffered from their neighbors by the woods. So it's a much easier situation to deal with in Cabrini than some other institutions in the township. They also have plans for adding to existing buildings, a new science center, new residence hall, new fine arts center, and some additions, and a new entrance on Eagle Road. Eastern University, they have plans before you for a new student center and dining hall has been approved. They're planning a gym addition. And of course, they have the land that they bought from Valley Forge. I've read newspaper articles talking about an Alzheimer's unit. I don't know if that's still active or if that was just a passing idea. Building heights. Right now, all the institutional districts have the same building height, 38 feet or three stories. Doesn't matter where you are, it's 38 feet or three stories. That's actually fairly restrictive for modern construction. And we would like to suggest a policy overall for the township to consider. And that idea is you'll be more restrictive at immediate perimeters next to residential districts than you are at the center of the campus. And you give flexibility towards the center of the campus, because in that case, they're really not impacting anybody. If a college or another institution wants to build a five-story building in the center of their campus, such as replacing the bookstore in Villanova with a five-story building or some other project, or Cabrini building a five-story building in the center of their campus, you probably won't even notice it. It gives flexibility for an institution to meet their needs in a way that has limited impact upon the community. And there's a lot of good reasons for taller heights. It gives you some better architectural designs, can give you taller foyers, taller entranceways for better architectural design, skylights. It's better for energy efficiency. It can reduce the pressure for an institution to expand outwards if they go upwards to meet their needs. It can maximize green space and help to preserve trees in wooded areas, but there's less land that's altered by going up. Your comprehensive plan says keep the institutions to the current institutional boundaries. Again, we're suggesting to add to that policy more flexibility on parts of the campus that are further away from homes and more protective measures closer to the immediate neighborhoods. As part of this, there's been discussion about whether there should be additional public meeting processes when there's a major institutional project involved, whether that should be a requirement in the ordinance. Should there be a process for advance written notice to the neighbors of a major project so that they know when it's being heard at a meeting by the institution? Should there be requirements where the township can require either security fencing or solid fencing or walls that help to deflect noise, help to control pedestrian access points, help to improve reduce visibility at certain locations? Right now, the only thing that has to be fenced is outdoor recreation. And for instance, someone proposes institutional use with a loading area, garbage trucks coming in at night, food delivery trucks coming in. It can create noise problems. A solid wall can help to deflect that noise if it's properly designed, for instance. The trees do not do much for noise, by the way. You need a barrier, like a wall. We suggest that your subdivision ordinance give you more authority to control access points. In the particular case of the Villanova parking deck, your police chief has expressed concerns about the access points in that scenario. And then a process question. As I said, Lower Merion and some other communities make institutional uses go through a special exception process before the Zoning Hearing Board. There's pros and cons to that. The similar process is a conditional use process with zoning approval by the Board of Commissioners. The two things are the same. The only difference is who does the approval. What a special exception or conditional use process does is it gives an extra step of approval. It gives the ability to place additional conditions upon the plan for zoning matters, to negotiate conditions or place conditions. And it gives an additional opportunity for the public to be heard and to have a little more control at the municipal level. The downside is it's more administrative work, it's more involvement, it's more work by the applicants, it's more time, more money. It does present another opportunity for people to challenge projects too. What we found in working with the big hospital in Lehigh Valley is they had problems where everything had to go for a special exception approval. They added a 300 square foot barber shop to their hospital and they had to go through a special exception hearing just for that. So you can also have a process where the larger projects have to go through this process and the smaller projects don't. What type of landscaping or berming should be used to provide buffers? The old way of doing buffers was a militaristic row of cheap arborvitae that keeled over on the first ice storm. The movement now is more naturalistic designs that look like they actually nature planted them as opposed to a low-bid landscaper. And earth berms that look less rigid too, that are more undulating and look like they fit in the landscape a little better. But landscaping is really critical. Tree preservation at the edges. When you look at the edge, for instance, of Eastern University, the edge of Cabrini, you'd hate to see a scenario where those trees were cut up to the Eagle Road or up to Valley Forge Road. I mean, it really would be a loss. So you could have some perimeter tree preservation provisions where the woods already exist. You have some buffer provisions right now for institutional districts. Should they be wider? Should they be taller? Right now, it's a 20-foot buffer with 5-foot evergreens and a 4-foot berm. Noise. There's lots of ways to control noise. There's the common way that the police deal with, and then there's the way of using zoning for a recurring noise problem. The recurring noise issue typically sets decibel levels at the boundary of a residential lot, and those noise levels are much stricter at night than they are during the day. and people can design around those noise levels. They can put up noise barriers if they need. They can put up noise absorbing material around mechanical equipment if needed to meet that noise level. There's also ways, if you wish, to go further on regulating student housing. There's a lot of communities that have regulations that require actual evictions if there's repetitive disorderly conduct, repetitive police actions against a certain number of tenants. Typically, it's three strikes, you're out. That's in place in a lot of college towns right now and some cities in Pennsylvania. And the idea is if somebody has a warning, they've gotten two citations against them, the third time they might be evicted, the idea is that that improves behavior. Parking. We're going to be recommending some adjustments to the parking provisions for institutional uses, looking at some of the data sources that are out there. We like to have some incentives for institutions to subsidize public transit for their staff if there's public transit nearby, or subsidies for shuttle services from an institution to a train station, for instance, or what's common is to subsidize a transit pass for staff and give them some incentive to do that to reduce parking demand and traffic. The sign provisions need to be revised. They really don't address institutions at all. Lighting is something we can control in zoning, particularly through spillover. Modern lighting design makes it really easy to direct lighting away from houses. We're going to suggest that the Planning Commission be asked with any comments, questions on these issues, and then the chairman, as he wishes, may ask for comments and questions from the public.
Thank you. So we'll start right there. Anybody from the board have questions?
Yeah.
Well, Charlie, go right ahead.
One of the problems we've run into in institutional zoning is not have sufficient parking regulations for the colleges. And I think we need to know not just the number of students, but the number of employees also, because we've never, at least in my asking, I've never been able to get a definite figure out of a college as to how many professors you have, are they full-time or part-time, what hours do they work, how many employees do you have in the stores and the food service and things like that, and any other employees on the campus. I'm sure they have that information because they pay them. It shouldn't be that difficult through the number of hours that they work and so forth to figure out where they're working, what hours they're working. But they've never given us that information as far as I can remember, because I know I've asked, especially recently with Cabrini and Eastern. And then they're evasive also in the number of students. We need to know the number of full-time students during the day, the number of part-time students in the evening courses, the number of graduate students.
It's very easy if your ordinance is updated to get that information. It's required.
Okay.
And the main thing that you're looking for is the peak number of staff persons and peak number of students on campus at one time.
Well, that's nice to have, but I also want to know the full number of employees they have, because I found in the past that they shade things, assuming that we're stupid and don't realize this stuff. I'd like to know what the numbers are. Then they can tell me the number of peak use, and this hour it's this, and this hour it's this. And night school starts at 6 o'clock or 7 o'clock or whenever that is, and most of the day classes are over by this date. That's fine. Give us the information. We've been around a long time. A lot of this we can figure out, and we really need to see the numbers.
I personally believe the parking numbers are better based upon that type of data than based upon square footage.
Well, square footage is nice, too. I want both.
Okay.
Because when we have something like Villanova coming in with basically a new city there, we need numbers on there. That's my comment at the moment.
So I have many others. To jump on Kathy's question here, have you seen another municipalities where that study that we're looking for is done by an independent as opposed to the applicant, just like a traffic study is done by a third party? Because it seems to be, it's easy for an applicant to come up and say, we're going to have 12 people, we're not going to add any more students, and we take what they are saying. But again, have you seen anywhere where there is a third party, much like a traffic study, would come in and actually give us that information?
There are communities that do require independent traffic studies. It's not normally done for a college if there's just normal parking, but it's theoretically possible if you think that's an issue. Normally, that information is done in a campus plan because they want to know what their demand is, too, and they want to do those calculations of how many people are on campus at a peak time. So they may not have shown it to you, but they've done the calculations.
Well, then, asking for it means a perfectly rational thing to do.
Oh, it's very, you just got to put it in your ordinance.
All right.
They have it. I mean, the campus plans I've seen have that data in it.
We are required, we do require them every to give us their campus plan.
They give you four pages and a map.
If we're lucky. And they give it to us once every 30 years. Yeah.
It's supposed to be every 10 years.
I know it's supposed to be.
I have a question also on parking. Another issue that's come up in some of the plans is that some of the institutions have significant summer programs and significant temporary, quote-unquote, programs that would exacerbate a situation where parking is already short. And in addition to that, when we're talking about standards and things, I know you commented that our two-student as opposed to three-student in individual homes, zoning was restrictive. I'm wondering if our parking regulations, such as they are now, are, quote, not restrictive enough compared to other municipalities. So I don't know if you have data. You've mentioned Lower Merion and, you know, things like that. I'd like to know how we compare in terms of our parking ratios.
I looked at Lower Merion specifically today because I thought people would ask about it because it's the most similar community, and I didn't see they're having good college parking numbers. The data is out there. The process is out there. I mean, we can look at other campus plans and how the calculation has been done. So it's not a hard thing to do. As far as the summer use, I mean, 99% of the time, the summer use is going to be much lower than the fall and spring use. I mean, there's occasionally going to be a special event. You can't plan for the 99th percentile in parking. You can't plan for the absolute worst day. It's otherwise you'd have seas of parking lots.
But the worst day is different from a summer of summer camp or whatever that maybe potentially has more cars coming and going than normal, especially in an institution where there's otherwise a lot of people in dorms, but the summer camp is daily traffic.
The other thing I think you need to consider is somebody like Villanova University that rents out their facilities on an ongoing basis. I call it the Suncourt, but I think it's something else now. What's the name of it? What used to be Sunbrook?
Conference Center,
right. That's basically a commercial use. And I think that needs to be figured in also, and other facilities that may be rented on there. That needs to be figured in with the traffic count also and the parking. So if they have X number of square feet that they're renting out, they need to have the parking that would support that as if it were a hotel or a conference center, if that facility is primarily used for that.
Or some other provision to deal with a situation when they have an unusual peak. For instance, if they had a big activity in the conference center, didn't have enough room for parking, and they had a shuttle service from their main campus in the summer, I think they've addressed their need.
But a lot of that is not done in the summer. And they might have shuttle, I know during games and homecomings and stuff like that, they have shuttles to other parking lots, but those other parking lots have traffic needs also. For example, Gennardi's parking lot. I don't think they're going there, but what parking lots are they going to? What parking lots do they have these arrangements with, and how is that affecting the traffic in that area?
I had a general question also, and I don't know how easy this is to ascertain or not. It seems to me that we have an extraordinary amount of acreage for our township devoted to this zoning, and I don't know if there's any way we can turn that around because there's been a failure to use or a suspension of activity of a particular use. I mean, it's almost as if the institutions at times run the township rather than the township taking or monitoring the institutions. There's so many acres involved.
I think it would be difficult to reduce the institutional zoning, but what you're saying to the institutions is, unless something really unusual occurs, these are your boundaries, and we're going to give you flexibility in the interior to use your land better, but don't come in and try to take more land and turn it over to a tax-exempt use.
Is Skip's point true, that we have a very high percentage of institutional?
There's a lot with higher. I think if you go in most boroughs and cities, it's higher. Carlisle is an incredible, Harrisburg is an incredible percentage of tax exempt. Have more institutions than most townships, yes.
Okay.
But I'm not sure that in land area it's higher than that many other communities.
I think it presents a particular problem when the universities, and it's not just Villanova, it's others also, are buying up residential property around them. And every time a house goes up for sale that's on the perimeter, it somehow disappears quickly. And I know about putting your boundaries in. However, I'm not sure if this can be addressed here, but we need to look at the tax burden on the residents that are left in the township, because it keeps going up, and they keep building these big, glorious buildings. And I'm not just referring to Villanova. But at some point, and I'm not sure that it can be done in the zoning. In fact, I'm pretty sure it can't be done in the zoning. But the taxation of the institutions needs to be addressed.
Zoning cannot regulate ownership. So if an institution buys a house and uses it as a house, there's no change.
As long as they pay taxes on it.
It's still taxable. Yep. It's only, your attorney can provide more detail on this, but it's only once it crosses a certain threshold under state law that it becomes tax exempt, and simply ownership does not make something tax exempt. And you could have commercial uses on institutional campus that are taxable. You could have offices on institutional campus that are taxable.
Do we have that now? Does anybody know?
I don't think they rent much out. I mean, typically you find it, for instance, in a hospital complex. Hospital complex, the doctor's offices are taxable, the hospital's tax exempt.
But, for example, Villanova has pretty much bought up all the property along Lancaster Avenue. And they were residences, and a lot of them are businesses and things like that. Are they paying property tax on that?
I don't know specifics on the properties and which ones have been converted to an institutional use and taken out of tax base, but I know that there is a portion of the conference center that does pay taxes on that land. So there is a portion of the Villanova holdings that is subject to the property tax.
And how about the properties along Lancaster Avenue?
I don't know the specifics on those.
Okay.
And you do have to realize this is something that's completely out of our hands.
I know.
You know, it's up to the state and federal government whether or not someone's tax exempt, and we're told that fact. It's not something that we really can control, you know, through our ordinances whatsoever.
I realize that, but I think it's something that at some point in time the township needs to address something in lieu of taxes. I'm just bringing it up now. I know we can't put it in these ordinances.
Educate me a little bit. Why can't the township put some minimal real estate tax on institutionals like Villanova or a church or college of some sort?
Because the state law says we can't. You know, once the state determines that a certain institution is considered nonprofit or meets those requirements, then the law says we can't tax them. We can only tax what's specifically listed under state law. They're very specific, narrow taxes that we can impose. We can't just make up taxes left and right. We only can impose certain taxes. And outside of that, they're illegal and we can't collect them. So the state it's not really the state that decides whether or not we can tax a certain entity or business or not.
Could we tax employees?
Once again, well, we do, because we have a, you know, earned income tax. That's right. One of the taxes we can impose, but we can't impose a head tax or something to that effect.
No, I don't mean a head tax, no.
So, but those, you know, there's basically about a half dozen taxes we can impose: earned income tax, the transfer tax, real estate tax, amusement tax. Those are the ones that the township has the ability to impose, and we can't just make up or decide, oh, this is something that we'd like, some activity we'd like to tax, let's go ahead and do it.
What often happens is there's negotiated payments, and particularly if the institution knows that they're going directly to police and fire protection, that's helpful. So, for instance, some communities have said, we ask you to pay a fee that's equal to 10% of the tax you would pay if you were taxable, and we will put all of that money to fire and police protection. And it's a negotiated thing. You can't require it. What Carlisle did in the past was they said to Dickinson College is anytime you want to expand your institutional district, we won't do it unless we have an agreement with you that you'll make up for the lost taxes of changing that district. Now, it was an informal process. It wasn't written into the code, but at least there was some negotiated process there because the township held the cards because they controlled the extent of the institutional district, and the borough did in that case.
In your materials, although it wasn't in the verbal presentation, you recommend that we consider increasing our setback slightly. With that, should I take that to mean that our current ordinance is not restrictive or not very restrictive? So that if the setbacks could be materially increased, that would have an impact on further development.
One of the things we like to recommend is you measure setbacks from the residential lots, not the residential boundaries. For instance, right now the residential boundary may be a road, it may be a rail line. We recommend you actually make it from the residential lot, but then you make it a little bit bigger. And again, the dormitories, the residence halls, fraternities, sororities are the things that are going to generate more noise. So those things typically have larger setbacks.
When you say increase slightly, is that 50%, 100%?
We haven't gotten that far yet.
Okay.
Kathy was mentioning the extra events that are not necessarily university or school-oriented. They're using their facilities, be it a conference center or a gymnasium, for some other event. Do you see that typically in other institutions in this area?
Or? Everybody's trying to maximize use of their facilities, and most of them sit vacant during the summers in particular. So you see more and more institutions trying to have summer activities.
And you see anywhere where
residence halls during the summer.
Where there's restrictions on that?
No. I don't typically see restrictions on that.
Thank you.
I think it's sort of relative to size. If it's a room that can handle 100 people and they're renting that out, that's not going to have a major impact. But if it's a stadium or a field house or a theater, for example, and especially if they build a theater, it's a good possibility that will be rented out to other groups of some sort. So they might have an event during the day. They will have events in the evening. How is that going to affect the night school numbers? So I think you need to address that type of parking perhaps in a different way than you would in just student parking. Because if they have a theater that would house 500, 600, however, do they have any idea what number the theater is going to have at this point if they build it? Don't go there? Okay. But, for example, that's a different a type of use, and it might be people who are not necessarily students that are coming to it. So I think that type of parking needs to be addressed too, and maybe it needs to be addressed specifically for the type of facility that they're putting on there, not just a classroom. It's not just square footage of a classroom, but the number of people you can put in there and what it could be used for, and they will rent it out if it's there.
Any other questions for Charlie?
Our current guidelines for parking, do they address those needs? I mean, when we're
not in sufficient detail.
I mean, I don't want us to overemphasize parking that's not going to be used, but we also need to know what traffic impacts truly are when these projects are approved.
What we recommend in a zoning ordinance is you have some processes for flexibility in parking, that they can go to the zoning hearing board as a special exception use and prove that excessive parking is being required or prove that they have some alternatives to deal with it. Because nobody wants extra pavement, nobody wants extra parking decks sitting vacant. Parking decks can cost $10,000, $15,000 of space. Underground parking can be $20,000, $30,000 of space. there should be a process for people to come in with exact data, more information, and have the zoning hearing board hear them out.
You mentioned that trees are very poor buffers, and the arborvitae is a little better. What kinds of natural plants are better buffers and so forth than trees? Being that they as an
I meant simply the cheapest, monotonous rows of evergreens we were trying to avoid. Okay. That's what we were trying to avoid. The ones that are not durable and don't hold up over time.
I had a question. In your presentation, you talked about trees and how it would be a shame that they would be cut down. Did you look simultaneously at our shade tree ordinance when you looked at this?
No, I should have. I did look at the zoning and subdivision. I did not look at the shade tree ordinance. I will do that.
And we actually just reviewed a new version of the shade tree ordinance, a potential new version. So you should probably look at both.
Okay. Good point.
Any other questions?
Yeah. One of the things we talked about, building height, certainly I understand that you can get greater height and have greater, you know, capacity and so forth. My concern would be, do we want, or is it reasonable for us to limit height or moderate height on something where it physically sits on a very high spot? I mean, the Hilltop School, for example, is called that because it's on the top of a hill. If you put a 35-foot building or 40-foot building up there, you'd see it for miles.
It's rare to regulate high points. You would have to have a really, really good reason to do it.
Just being ugly wouldn't be one, huh?
Well, zoning is supposed to be grounded in public health and safety and authorized purposes in the planning code. The scenic issues get a little more difficult to justify.
I think the concern every time an institutional plan is in front of everyone is that we're being told student increase will not occur, but everyone's thinking more buildings, more students, more traffic, more. Is there any way to plan such that you really do know how that, other than them giving us more information as far as student enrollment, but have you had enough history with other institutions to know when that's a false fear or if that's a true concern?
I don't know of any other community in Pennsylvania that regulates enrollment. They do in Washington, D.C. It's the only place I know where they actually regulate enrollment. And of course, they have a different set of laws down there. Certainly, if the enrollment is tied to parking, I think you have a way to require them to periodically show they're complying with that requirement. And if their enrollment goes above it, they at minimum have to provide more parking.
Have you seen in other ordinances a requirement that the institution prevent freshmen or sophomores from having cars on campus?
It's a common policy in colleges. What you're seeing is the more affluent colleges are moving away from it because it becomes a marketing thing to say to freshmen you can bring your car to campus, and the freshmen have nicer cars than the faculty do. So I don't know of a way to do that with zoning. I can imagine a scenario where there would be a negotiated condition where the college would say that the housing that's closest to the residences would not be occupied by freshmen, with the eye that the freshmen are a little noisier than the upperclassmen and hopefully a little more mature. That's a negotiated matter. That's not a zoning ordinance issue.
My concern is when they do tell freshmen that they can't have cars, they have cars anyway, but they keep them off campus.
Yes.
And then they become congested. Streets become congested with students' cars. So I think you're really better off letting them have cars and accommodate the cars on campus because they're going to have them anyway, and you might as well handle it.
I knew somebody who worked for Lafayette College, and he said every single student came in with a letter about a sick grandma that they had to go visit, so they needed to have a car.
Exactly.
Early in your presentation, you were talking about the difference between Lower Merion's approval process versus Radnor has boundaries. When we had the conversation last year about the student housing ordinance, one of the pieces of research that I uncovered is that Radnor is, in this area, singularly unique in the number of institutions that we have and the number of students that we have relative to our overall population. There's a third, and that's not the same numbers as down in Lower Marion or in any of the other communities.
Okay.
So my question is kind of two-part. Have you worked with other institutions or other communities that are like Radnor in that regard, where there's such a high proportion of students, residents, and so many institutions of higher learning, you know, in the same, roughly speaking, geographical area, to know, you know, so that we could kind of, some things you may have done in the past that worked well, didn't work well. Because I do think that Radnor's very unique in that regard, and it makes us particularly vulnerable to changes to the PI zoning and growth on the parts of the institutions. And I think that it has followed suit that even with 10-year plans, institutions say they have no planned enrollment, you know, growth, but then they build more buildings. And, you know, interestingly, in fact, these universities have all grown over the last 10 to 15 years, even though every single one of them, you know, at one point or another presented projects that they said would not have were not associated with enrollment growth, and yet we are sitting with far more students in Radnor. So chicken or the egg, I mean, I'm not going to say that they, you know, that was purposeful on their part, but it may be an unintended consequence, and it could happen so many times that you have to kind of expect it to be an intended consequence. There's a point at which you have to say that. So I'd be curious about your experience with that. And also, you know, does that mean that we should be particularly, where some of these flexibility ideas, you know, some of them may have been your ideas, some of them may have come from some of the institutions, some of them may have come from, you know, people with whom you've met in your research.
We have actually not met any of the institutional representatives in Radnor.
You've not met yet with the institutions?
Correct.
So the information that you gathered here that is institution-specific, you gathered it from the township?
Yes.
Okay. It makes me wonder if we need to be particularly vigilant to protect the neighborhoods. And it's not enough, really, to say that 200-foot buffer or 125-foot buffer in many instances, in my case, because I think one of the biggest things that Radnor is subjected to is the traffic, the consequence of traffic. And it's one thing to have a bunch of kids walking around. It's a very different thing to have them driving through our neighborhoods, you know, whether or not it's to go to an off-campus house or an off-campus party or what have you, or driving between classes or being a commuter student. Villanova has a fair number of commuter students as well. And some of the and other institutions in the township have graduate, you know, the other aspect that I haven't heard addressed here, and that is an explosion in Radnor Township, are the night classes and the graduate school classes that are occurring. I mean, it's weekly I hear an ad about one of the institutions that is specifically marketing their evening graduate school program.
That's a growth industry.
It's a huge growth industry that all of these, so these institutions are maybe saying we're not planning on growing our undergraduate growth, but their night school and their graduate school and their commuter school traffic is growing hugely, and that impacts us. So those are the, you know, those are some of my concerns as we look to try to find balance that has the universities be vibrant, but not put our neighborhoods and our township as a whole at risk. You know, individual neighborhoods don't have to be at risk for the township as a whole to be at risk because of the traffic issues that we encounter.
Just to answer your very first question, we've worked in a number of communities where the students are half the population. Carlisle, Millersville, East Stroudsburg working right now. So we're familiar with a lot of these issues. And again, none of them have been regulating enrollment. I mean, they've been leaving the market to bear.
Well, I don't think we can regulate enrollment.
Right.
Although I would be curious on what grounds Washington, D.C. is able to do that.
They have their own codes. I mean, they are, in effect, a state and a city. So that, too.
Those are my things that I'll be looking at, is because I do view Radnor as singularly vulnerable in this particular area, and I see a lot of people nodding their heads.
Let's move to public comment and questions for Mr. Schmeel. Charlie, I think the easiest thing, why don't you take the chair on the end?
That'd be great.
And we'll let everyone come up one at a time. If you want to raise your hand, if you have a comment, I'll just point to you so we don't have a mass rush to the microphone. Do I have anyone public comment?
Hi, I'm Colleen Price, and I live at 352 Shimoni Road. I have a number of questions. The first is about the timing and how this whole procedure is going to unravel. I understand that URDC was retained in the fall, and the first time we hear about it is in June. And I know I've been at meetings before where we said we're not going to talk about big legislation over the summer because nobody's here to talk about it. And it seems like we're starting now, June 7th. It just seems really to be bad timing. And what is the timing about how quickly could a zoning amendment be done?
We are available to meet as often as the township wishes, as frequently as the township wishes.
Okay. The light just went on. We're available to meet as frequently as the township wishes. There was some delay because of staff changes. The community development director left, then the assistant manager left, and we waited till Kevin was on board to really get geared up. But we're ready to meet and move forward on this as quickly as the township wishes.
Well, I'm just saying I think it's really not plausible to do it over the summer. But there are a lot of people who would like to come. They're going to be on vacation, and it's going to start in a week. So I think this is bad timing, and maybe it should be delayed till September when people are back and you can organize and get.
I think we need to work on it because if we keep delaying and delaying, all the development's going to be done. We need to have this in place as soon as possible because the institutions are coming in all the time. And not everybody goes away for summer. Yeah, people might be away here and there. Make it a point to catch up with the township meetings are on the internet. It's very easy to catch up. But we cannot wait, I feel, during the summer and put this on hold. Then you have the holidays, and then you have something else. We really need to move forward with it as quickly as possible.
Charlie, I think it may be helpful if you go through the process of all the steps that need to happen before you actually put pen to paper for actually ordinance regulations. There's a significant amount of research that is still left to be done. So it may be helpful to describe that process that needs to happen, the additional public meetings that you're proposing to do as part of this before we even get into drafting regulations?
That will be a question we'll work on in the staff of the exact schedule. But typically what happens is there certainly is a requirement for a public hearing by the Board of Commissioners. And if we want to time that to avoid Christmas and summer, the best time to try to do that would be October or November. I don't know if that's possible, or January. So if you work backwards from that date, it's good for the Planning Commission to be working now on the drafts so that we can have the public meetings at an opportune time when most people are available. But we will be having a process involving many people. That next set of meetings has not yet been scheduled.
Well, I mean, again, I don't think that it's a good idea to push forward legislation when people aren't here who are going to be vested. I know in particular I have plans this summer that I don't usually have and I'm not going to be around, so that concerns me. My other question is, too, has anybody noticed that the world is broke except for colleges? I mean, we've got $300 million from Villanova, we've got $40 million from Eastern, got $35 million on Cabrini's plans. I mean, I think they're the next bubble that's going to burst. I have from the College Board, the people who published the SAT, the demographics went through the roof. There were so many kids applying to college the last few years, it was crazy. They have doubled the college tuition rates in the last 10 years. Doubled. Everybody's gone down. College tuition has gone up because they just had, you know, they were shooting fish in a barrel. Well, that number is going to drop off by 15%. And that's not according to me. This is according to the College Board publishes the SAT, and it was also in Eastern's plan. So talking about this need for growth doesn't make any sense because the demographics aren't there and someone isn't going to give birth to an 18-year-old tomorrow. So I don't understand why there's any impetus here to have growth, other than you've got people who are bloated with a ton of money that are really building a lot of fluff. I mean, it's student union centers, so we can have the Chick-fil-A in there, and it can be more attractive, and you'll feel better about spending $56,000 a year to send your kid to Villanova. I mean, I really don't understand at all why we're talking about growth. And if you are going to do growth, you know, assume that they're going to go through the roof. If they really need to go and put five-story buildings up, put them straight through the center of Villanova. Go put them over at Cabrini, Eastern, and Valley Forge. And you tell me how many kids will be in those dorms, and we will be outnumbered by college students. And there's no way to control it. We're not allowed to cap enrollment. You're going to allow parking garages wherever. They can have five-story parking garages to, you know, absorb the people that just went in the five-story dorm that you just ran through the center of town. I don't get it. You're building a mini city across from Villanova, again, when the demographics don't support it. You know, the loans are the Stafford loans, all these loans, you know, we can't keep funding these people forever. They're artificially supported by the taxpayers because all these kids who are going to college who can't afford it are getting loans through us. And when that rate goes up, it's another reason that you may lose people. So, again, I don't see where the growth idea is coming from. You're talking about, you know, Carlisle. Carlisle is kind of like an industrial town. I wouldn't compare Carlisle to Radnor. And Dickinson's got, what, 3,000, 4,000 people? I mean, we have a third of our population. We've got over 10 or 11,000 students in a small town. You go to Lower Merion, they've got 4,000 students between Bryn Mawr and Haverford. They don't have five-story buildings. They don't allow big parking garages. Everything comes in through a special exception. And if you have a traffic issue and you've got a C or below rating, you get absolutely no growth in Lower Merion. That doesn't happen here. We just say, oh, that's a shame. You're already an F. Just keep going. I mean, I really don't understand where it's coming from, and I feel like there isn't a resident who's ever come up to the board and said, hey, we really need more college students. It would just really be great for this township. But it seems to just keep coming at us like that somebody wants it, and I don't know if it's just the institutions. The special exception idea gives you great control. Not allowing parking garages in institutions gives you great control. It's the only way you could possibly control enrollment. And if you're going to allow five-story buildings, you not only have no control of enrollment, you can expect it to go through the roof if that's what they're going to do. And the same thing on cars. You know, we're going to say the freshmen don't have cars, whatever. Assume everybody has a car. All these schools are regional schools. The kids are coming from New York and New Jersey. They all have cars. They all need a place to park. I got lots more, but I don't want to hog the whole night. So thank you very much for listening.
Mr. Chairman, if I can just respond to one specific point.
Sure.
You've made a lot of valid points, but there's one specifically I just wanted to provide comment on. Villanova has very overcrowded dormitories. Their first-year dormitories, their lounges are quadruples, and I think half the first-year students are living in triples that are forced. So part of it is that they need to deal with their overcrowding. And there's a trend where more and more of their students do want to live on campus, and the off-campus housing is expensive, so they'd like to live on campus for that. One thing to keep in mind is in a lot of the communities we work with, they want as much of the students that are out there, they want as much of them living on campus because then they've got the campus police, they've got the campus rules, versus when they're off campus, it's the township's problem. If they're on campus, it's the college's problem, and it's less work for everybody and less problems with the neighborhood if the college is able to control the behavior.
Yeah, but you can't legislate that they will keep their students on campus. You can't cap their numbers. You can't force them to keep them on campus. And Villanova did this 20 years ago. They rezoned that whole Morris Tract. They put all their dorms on their south campus, and they said that's because we want to get everybody contained here. And they were going to drop to 5,700 students, and they're up at, what, 7,000, 8,000 in their undergraduate population. It's like a ridiculous argument. If they want to put people in dorms, then accept less people.
I have one comment for you, though, about the student housing. The new ordinance that we have, first off, makes it, once that use stops and you're within 1,000 feet of another student house, you can't resume it. Once you stop having three students in the house, you cannot go back to having three students in the house. There's a break in the use that will finally get some of the students out of the neighborhoods.
And that would be great.
And that's in there now, as I understand it.
Yeah, but it is two students, because you're not allowed to have any more than two unrelated anywhere.
And when we took
a risk,
I don't
know why you go up for students.
In planning and the township as well, we took a risk in some way of doing two, because a lot of communities do three.
Right, but
and we were told by John Rice that we could be challenged on that.
And we haven't been challenged. No, don't.
Let's not jinx things. But my other comment is, though, perhaps when Villanova did the project years ago and there was a temporary removal of students from the neighborhoods, this will be much more in comparison of a permanent removal, as I understand it.
But you have no way to enforce that.
No, you do. You do. You cannot have, if people are renting suddenly now to three students, they can close that down.
But if they
take the license back. I think there was an incident recently somewhere that somebody lost their license.
But if they're going to allow three students to be together, if that's part of it.
They're not. It's two.
It's two, but he's suggesting you go to three.
No. He said other communities do three and that we have a restrictive ordinance.
And I said if you wanted to do something, you might allow an apartment complex as three.
Well, in particular, the two apartment complexes down the street from me, right on the corner of Shimoni Road, actually wrote to the Planning Commission when that was up for grabs and said that they would convert then to student housing. And then you'd have student housing apartments right on Lancaster Avenue with, you know, Go Nova hanging out. It changes the neighborhood.
We don't have to do that either.
I agree with you. I'm making a comment on that as well. Thanks.
Thank you.
Charlie, while Mr. Geary walks up, where did you get the information about Villanova's overcrowded dormitories?
My son considered going to Villanova last year, and it was an issue.
Okay, thank you.
It's public knowledge. If you talk to anybody going to Villanova, they can tell you the first year dorms are very crowded.
Kevin Geary, Blackfriar Road, and I really thank you guys for holding this and allowing the consultant actually be questioned by the public. Can you clarify your comment when you talked about that the number of college students within Radnor vis-a-vis other is it fair to say that within southeastern Pennsylvania, that as a percentage that we have the most college students?
Probably among townships.
Okay. Yeah, obviously, you're not taking, like, Philadelphia wouldn't count as that. You're referring to, like, Radnor, Lower Merion, similar type university.
I can't think of another township that has a higher percentage of students.
Okay. And you've talked a lot about the growth of Villanova, growth of universities, growth of institutionals here. And one of the things that we've seen over the last 20, 30 years is the growth of education as a for-profit business. Universities now, as I think you mentioned, you know, having a car on freshman campus is a marketing tool. Universities are now being forced to, just by the nature of what it is, to have the most updated facilities, the most updated library, most updated athletic. And because of that, universities are more and more investing their capital in their capital campaigns and loans into those type of facilities. What is happening, and I'm interested in what your comments are to this series of questions, are more and more universities are going to for-profit companies for the funding and the leasing of the dorms. They say, okay, you know, you give us $200 million to fund the construction of this dorm, we'll give you a 99-year lease to it. You basically, you know, get most of the money, and therefore the university gets the huge benefit of it. In reviewing this, how many universities currently in Radnor operate on that or plan to operate under that scenario?
I don't know about Radnor. I know it's pretty much happening at all the Pennsylvania state-owned universities.
Okay. Because I know it happened at St. Joe's facility sort of on 54th and City Line, that's I think it might be a Texas company that owns it. What happens then to a local community's control over that facility in terms of being able to regulate it when it's really, in all for intents and purposes for the next 99 years, a private company's building, a private company's land? How is that also taxed? Is that still treated as nonprofit status, even though there's a for-profit entity making money off of the facility and the land?
In East Stroudsburg, for instance, it is an affiliated group. I don't think it's for profit, but mm-hmm. It's an affiliated group that's financing it, and they lease they handle all the financing for the new residence halls, but the university still owns the ground.
Right. So how does then the local community deal with that on a tax basis? Do they get the tax?
I don't know.
The land? Okay. But there are for-profit companies, not just unaffiliated nonprofit entities that are probably just making money off of the interest. I mean, it seems kind of weird to do a nonprofit entity for a 99-year lease with $15,000 a year in rental fees. But that's their tax issue, not Radnor's. When you look at the institutional zoning and you look at the institutional sort of growth, and growth is, at the end of the day, it's parking spaces equals students, students equals big, students equals more. Do you have any idea, looking at each of these institutions, even going to something like Agnes Irwin, what should be their maximum type? I know we can't regulate it, but I think it would be helpful for township to know. Say, you know what, I look at this and I say, you know what, they can probably, we can probably fit another 5,000, 6,000 students into Radnor. Like, what is the, I guess, what's the threshold to say we are at the wall, we can't sort of take this, both day and sort of night? I mean, I guess more day because they're more residential and that gets the buildings. Like, could Cabrini double in size and that in the township could still hang on to that, you know, or absorb that?
The process is that zoning does not try to regulate everything. Mm-hmm. You know, we have to let the market function. So we regulate certain traditional land use issues, and we don't try to control every aspect of development in a community. So for instance, yes, Cabrini could easily double in size. They have the land, mm-hmm. as an example.
And with in the township, in terms of traffic, in terms of all infrastructure, could it still absorb that?
As far as traffic, our main process is the traffic impact process, mm-hmm. and then if they have any driveway onto a state road, then PennDOT can also require off-site improvements. The township is pretty much limited to on-site improvements and what they can require.
When you talked about traffic study, and I'll take two more questions, and I'll let somebody else get up. When you talked about traffic studies, you sort of mentioned it that it should be early in the process before they go for zoning overlays, variances, etc. Is that the norm, or when should traffic studies, from a taxpayer and citizens' view, when should traffic studies be done, so we get the best knowledge and the best information? How long do those studies take?
A month. Most communities require traffic studies for major subdivisions and land developments, mm-hmm. and they also require them before major zoning map change.
And then finally, when institutions are sort of going for variances and things like this, how many go for zoning overlays? How many go for just, hey, you know what, we want to take this 13-plus acre site, rezone it, not go through planning commissions? What is the norm in Pennsylvania?
An overlay really is very similar to a district. It's just a layered process, but it, for all intents and purposes, it's the same process. If you have a zoning overlay or a zoning district change, you have to go through the same procedures.
And is Radnor, the process that Radnor sort of deals with that, is that consistent with area townships?
Everything is set by the planning code, state planning code.
Okay. No more questions. I just, you know, one thing, you guys obviously have a lot of work to do and a big job over the future, but it's very clear, both from what Villanova sort of put forth today without taking any public comment or any sort of neighborhood meetings, and with what you guys are going to do with all the other zoning here and all the other planned institutions, this is really the future of Radnor. We're looking at the next 50 years of Radnor Township right here in this room on your desks. Are we going to be a place that's going to be a great place for families, for businesses, for people to come, raise their families, go to good schools, have a great community, or are we going to be known as a college town? This is really it. You know, we're going to know what Radnor looks like in 2050 when you guys are done with this. And, you know, in 30 years, I still hope to be living here and paying my fair share of taxes in this township. And, you know, I think a lot of people love this township. We moved here 5 years ago because of the schools and the community, and have grown to love it even more. And I just, you know, really, as you make these recommendations and you vote on this, this is it. This is really what the township's going to be. You know, we can talk about budgets, we can talk about pensions, we can talk about all that stuff that's very important to the township. The fabric, the whole-scale nature of our schools, our community, these universities are really in your hands. And we really are going to trust and look for you guys to be our guidance here, because you are going to be, you are the fathers of the new Radnor. Fathers and mothers of the new Radnor, and what this township looks like in the next 20 or 30 years. So thanks.
Thank you. Any other public comment? Sir?
Jim Yiannopoulos, 15 Braxton Road. I wondered, with zoning ordinances, whether some other things besides looking at traffic are studies that could be required. For example, looking at the impact on infrastructure. Is that something that is typically done?
I saw that the utility system may need some upgrades, particularly for the Villanova project. Typically, what happens is any developer, public or private or nonprofit, has to do whatever is needed as far as water and sewer systems to make their project work, and they have to pay for those improvements. Stormwater is a whole different issue. There's plenty of regulations and procedures dealing with stormwater. And then traffic, we've talked about.
So you mentioned sewer system, water, things like the water pressure. There are studies they can do on that. For example, the Bloomfield estate on South Ithan, I remember after it burned down, one of the firemen was quoted as saying that it was hard to fight the fire because they didn't have enough water pressure. I wonder, are those the sorts of things that can be looked at in terms of potential impact?
They should be. Your engineer from Gilmore Associates is here. That's often looked at with a major project. You look at what the water pressure will be after the completion of the project and make people do upgrades. I mean, you really need it for the construction code. You have to show that you have adequate water pressure and supply.
What about economic impact? Because I do feel like there's an assumption that's always made that development is good, that it's going to bring more revenue to the township. We hear the institutions talk about how many employees they have, certainly. How many of their students, spend how much money, how much revenue it brings to the township. But there are limits to growth. And if you look at, for example, Villanova and that particular piece of proposed development, is that something that could be required, is looking at truly what the economic impact is? I can imagine a scenario, for example, where if congestion is increased, everyone in Radnor Township who lives east of Villanova stops going to Wayne to do any of their shopping and ends up in Bryn Mawr and Ardmore and we actually lose revenue. So that is something that could be looked at.
Those are issues you would look at with the traffic study, and we recommend a traffic study be done before a major zoning map change.
But they could also do an economic analysis.
Well, the traffic study would at least start to tell you how severe the congestion would be, and that would start to issue your issue about redirected traffic, for instance.
I appreciate several of you bringing up the issue of the caps. I mentioned in another meeting that back on January 4th, there was a meeting with Villanova and some of the neighbors, and the president of Villanova at that time said, "I know what you're thinking. I want to reassure you. I promise you, and I'm willing to put it in my own blood, that we're not increasing the student body." Now, since that time, we've had presentations by Villanova, for example, where they've said, "Oh, no, we could not guarantee that." It seems to me that with zoning ordinances and the rules for exception, there are ways to control those numbers. Perhaps not, as you mentioned, at Cabrini if they've got tons of space, but perhaps at other institutions if they don't.
The meeting that I watched the video of, the representative of Villanova said that their bond council would not let them commit to an enrollment capacity. So they have a policy of keeping their enrollment the same. The president promised it, but they can't put it in a legally binding contract, because the way that the bond ratings work is they look at your yield, they look at your admission rates, and they figure that if you get in financial trouble, you can increase your enrollment. They want to be able to see that.
Okay. And I also appreciate several of you mentioning the concern or issue around institutions buying up residential properties and the impact on the tax base. I'd like to point out that in some instances, institutions have bought up residential properties, and instead of maintaining and improving them, in some cases, they've actually demolished the buildings, which, of course, increases the taxes for the rest of us. That $400,000 piece of property suddenly becomes a $60,000 or $70,000 piece of land, and the rest of us pay more for it. So that is a genuine concern. Finally, I just would like to agree with Kevin. This is a big thing you're looking at. This could impact the township forever, and it's sitting here on your plates. It really is a question of, do we want to remain a really great town with, you know, really great public schools, really great Little League, all that stuff we love, downtown Wayne just the way we love it, or are we going to end up becoming more of a college town? I hope we'll remain more of a town that has some really great colleges in it as opposed to become a college town. Thanks.
Thank you.
Brian Price, 352 Shimoni Road. You know, I mean, you talk from the noises for the things and all, and then that the noise you put that on to police, so that's another burden on the township and the police to, you know, stop the noise down.
We said there's two ways to deal with noise. One is the police dealing with the immediate matter with a citation. The other is recurring noise that the township can deal with through other ordinances.
The other thing, they were talking about the tax burden on everybody and they tax the employees and all that. Our township doesn't have a tax, an earned income tax for anybody. So
you're fortunate.
Well, yeah, I am. So I pay it in real estate tax instead. So the colleges should pay. You know what? If the residents don't pay, the colleges and the instructors and all their, you know, their athletic people should pay the tax. That would offset all the land that they're hogging for free.
Does the township have a local services tax, $52 per year per employee? Okay, you are allowed to do that.
$52.
$52 is what is allowed.
I paid $28,000. $52. I could get on the train for that for the month. Okay.
That's for everybody employed in the township except the very lowest wage people.
When I walked in today, I thought you worked for Villanova. I didn't understand that you actually are trying to work for this township. You poked holes in every single thing that this township stood for how long have we been writing ordinances? 100 years? You poked a hole in every single thing for development and for the institutions. I thought you worked for Villanova. So, and you didn't know anything about the Shade Tree Commission, and you're missing Carroll, which is a huge parcel of land. You've been working since October. I think you got to do some more homework. And if Villanova is so worried about dorms and parking, instead of putting bookstores and hotels or bars over in that, they should fill that place. If they're going to build anything, seven stories, they should build all dorms if they're that concerned about the township and the people that live here. Thanks.
Thank you. Anyone else? Sir?
Good evening. My name is Philip R. I'm on Meredith Avenue in Rosemont. Thank you again for having this meeting, allowing us to have some comment, and thank you for taking our calls and our comments, too. I only have two issues. One is I wanted to get some clarity on this issue of the idea of shifting students out of the neighborhoods into the college campus. And the first question I have is I wonder, do we have any information about how many students, Villanova or overall, do reside in Radnor Township as opposed to other outlying areas? Do we happen to know that number, or is there a way to get that at some point?
I'm sorry, could you repeat the question?
Sure. Do we know how many students, whether it be from Villanova or including others, live out, you know, in the neighborhoods or in Radnor Township as opposed to other townships in the area?
We do not have that information. I believe there's census information out there, but I do not have that information.
Okay. Go ahead. That's fine.
What you would do is you would take... Actually, The only data the township would have is numbers of registered student homes.
Mm-hmm.
The question is, are people lying in those applications and are people filling out the applications?
Right. Okay. All right. Well, that's a good point. My point really goes to the fact that that Radnor Township is not the only place that these students live. They live outside. They're in Ardmore. They're in Narberth. They go as far away as Manayunk. They're in Tredyffrin, probably. I mean, King of Prussia, even. I mean, these people, and these are not locals. These are people living there. So the idea that Villanova is taking, or any university that builds more dorms, is taking students out of the neighborhoods, it almost becomes a canard as far as Radnor's concerned, because they're not likely to be taking them out of Radnor's neighborhood. And I'd like to get your comment on that, because that's the closest ones. I would think that the outlying ones would be where they come out first. And given the fact that even Villanova's admission that they're going to have 15% of students still living off campus, which is about 900 to 1,000, that's more likely to stay in Radnor. So I don't see the benefit for Radnor itself by taking students out of the neighborhoods. They're not coming out of the Radnor's neighborhoods. And I wanted to get your comment on that and how you might see that logic.
Interesting point. I don't know the answer.
Okay. Well, something to consider, especially as we tout that as a benefit to Radnor. I think it's a benefit to other townships, but I don't see the benefit to Radnor from that point of view. Doesn't mean it's good or bad. It just means that it's not a point that benefits Radnor, I think. Second question has to do with the fact that, well, let me ask the question. How many institutions in all restricted to Southeast Pennsylvania have a major U.S. highway going straight through the middle of their campus?
There are a lot of universities with four-lane highways running through, and as I mentioned, they often have a pedestrian bridge over them.
Okay. And now, when you say four-lane highway, that means does that mean like a real highway, or does that mean
similar situations like Lancaster Avenue?
Like Lancaster Avenue, okay. And how is that treated? I mean, this is a community road that local people use to traverse the township, as well as other people who are going from Ardmore, or we're all the way out to Tredyffrin or something like that. So this is a community road. Is that treated like a commercial piece of property? Like anything can go, anything can happen on either side of that road and doesn't affect anybody? Or is that more like a residential piece of community where what happens on the borders of that matter to the community and how it looks, how it portrays itself, and how it gives itself an identity?
It's certainly a very big part of the identity of the township.
Okay. All right. Good. Appreciate it. Thanks very much for considering those ideas as you go ahead and present your plan. Thank you.
Thank you.
Charlie, while the next speaker walks up, that was actually something, the question he raised about the surrounding communities. We go as far away as Conshohocken, you know, has Villanova students. And if supply and demand being what it is, if you're a student rental, housing rental in Radnor, and you don't want to lose your license, if you go a year without renting, you lose your ability to rent here without going through our zoning process. And that has been a concern of mine, is that we're not necessarily going to decrease the number of students in this town, but rather just shift who those student housing renters rent to, whether it's to Villanova or, you know, they try to pick up from some of the other colleges in the area so that they don't lose their student rental capability. And that's, you know, we can't force kids to move onto campus, and we can't force it to only be the Radnor people to give up their student rentals. So that's been something that's been a concern to me.
And I'm Marie Hessman, Barley Cone Road Lane. I have a math problem I've been kind of cooking on, and I'm hoping that as we go through this process, we can get really clear about some numbers. Can someone remind me what the difference is between the current parking capacity on the surface lots and the planned capacity for the parking garage, which is currently not even allowed at the height it's planned at?
The material that Villanova has provided was that the number of spaces in the parking deck would be equal to the number of spaces lost from the surface lots.
Equal. Do we know how many what their attendance numbers are for graduation?
We're not going to talk any specifics.
Sorry?
Again, we're not going to talk specifics about any of the plans tonight. Just general questions.
Okay.
Well, Charlie can answer, but we don't want to get into anything.
We're talking about traffic studies. I'd like to see a usage study, I don't know what you'd call it, honestly, in planning, but I'm not hearing this math being run, the math of the comparison between the current and planned compared to, I have a picture, I don't know if it'll actually show up on my phone, so I'll try and bring it the next time there's something, but of what happened the last graduation, the field. Can we see if I can get this on the screen? Does the overhead thing?
Jim's back there.
Is it what? I don't, this may not come out okay.
I've got a great picture of a great public township.
Everybody got that one.
No, it's a phone picture. I'll have to get a printout or something. But essentially, the graduation numbers are so large that some years they spill out onto all the residential streets. This year, I know at least one spillover was they had cars parking all over Pike Field behind my house. And so that's what happens when they have one large event. And so I'm concerned about what happens when there's something in the chapel while classes are in session, when there's a show in the venue, when all the students are home, and when there's an event at the stadium. I want to know what happens when those numbers are run. And if I don't think it's practical as an institution that they could selectively schedule everything they have. I don't think anybody could really do that schedule math. So I'd like to know that realistic calculations on what would happen if most of these different places that now utilize the parking capacity and the additional places that would be using parking capacity, what numbers are we talking about? I want to see those numbers. Thank you.
Thank you.
Tony Bailey, Barclayton Road. I'd like to know, has anybody proposed a study on the impact that this will have on the environment, you know, in the surrounding community? And also, we have a very viable church for the community. I'd like to know what the numbers for the parking for those church members would be.
For which church, ma'am?
For any church. St. Thomas of Villanova Church. It's on campus.
Again, we're not talking details tonight.
But in general.
In general, with environmental, you're welcome to answer the question.
In general, parking for a church is one parking space for every equivalent of three seats, is a fairly common standard. I haven't looked to see exactly what Radnor's requirement is. Now, in that case, I mean, a number of the students are on campus, so it might have to be adjusted. As far as environmental impact, the first thing we said to the township was you should beef up your riparian buffer standards, the green areas required along creeks. Since that time, the state has beefed up their requirements, but that may get changed by the state. So we do, it's particularly important for water quality to have thickly vegetated areas along waterways. And that's something that should be done throughout the entire township. That's the biggest environmental protection need in Radnor. As far as environmental impact on the institutions themselves, again, most of the property has to remain landscaped as an end result. In the case of the particular Villanova project, it's all parking right now. So there's actually might end up being an improvement because the federal NPDES process requires a lot of infiltration measures, water quality measures, and a new if you're taking an existing development site and doing new development, the end result is going to be better because of these federal requirements.
Well, my concern is during the process, what would be the environmental impact during the process? The building, you know, plaster, whatever it is, concrete flying through the air, how is that going to impact the environment, including air that we all breathe?
I'm not aware of any studies of air quality impacts from construction activities. Most of the attention is focused on erosion control, sedimentation controls, which is fairly well taken care of nowadays. And that's usually the main attention. I mean, you're going to have some air quality impacts from construction equipment. That's the nature of the business. I don't have any other answers.
Well, I do think it is important that that be looked into, because that is going to impact not just the community, but the surrounding area as well of Radnor Township. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other public comment? With that, I'll close the public comment. Oh, one more.
I'm sorry, Colleen Price again. I just want to know, how would I go about scheduling a meeting or getting a meeting with my neighbors? How do we know what the next step is?
That was my next question. Would you like me to come back to a planning commission?
Would you like me to come back for another Planning Commission meeting to follow up upon these points and further our discussion?
Kevin, I'm going to turn to you what the next step we think from the township side. Do we know yet? Or is that?
I don't think that we have looked that far ahead. I know that, again, as I mentioned earlier, that the specifics of the Villanova proposal will be discussed Monday the 18th with the commissioners. Their proposal, their petition is up on the website. It's on the front page. There's a link to that. That will be discussed separately from the general research and the general institutional work that Charlie and URDC is working on. I think it would be best that we take a look at where Charlie's at, what his next steps are, what additional information, if he's planning on doing some key person interviews and meetings with community groups and the institutions, before then we come back to present some of that in front of the Planning Commission again.
Thank you.
I think we also asked a number of questions up here on planning that Charlie was not ready at this time to answer, and I'd like to see those answers too before we proceed.
I would think that at the next meeting we could probably start with kind of a summary of tonight's meeting and answer some of those questions. I know Charlie's taking some notes and Sue is taking the minutes. Those minutes will be posted on the website, but then that'll enable Charlie the opportunity to prepare. It probably won't be within the next month, because I'm sure that there's going to be some significant research and meetings that need to be done so we can start moving this process along so that we can get a draft ordinance prepared.
Is it possible to set up a schedule, a target schedule? And I know we can't do it now because I don't know how much time is involved, what you would need, and so forth. But I'm really concerned about, well, let's put this off a month, then we'll put that off a month. Then you're in August, nobody's around. I would like to see a schedule. Not everybody goes away all the time. And I think it's important to start working through these things because this will have a lot of detail in it. And we really need time, not to just have an ordinance thrown at us and then we just say yes, no, or whatever. But we need time to study it and have input with it and possibly look at other townships' ordinances. If you can get copies to us of some that you think are good. They maybe have certain sections that you think would work in this situation. But I'm really concerned about not having a schedule. I'd like to see a definite schedule. Every 2 weeks we do this. Once a month we do this. We should meet to do this. And I think that you could set out within the next 2 weeks of target your next 6 months and how you're going to push forward on this.
As part of the proposal that URDC prepared going through the RFP process, Charlie, there is a schedule that you had kind of roughed out as far as what each process is part of this process was going to take, how long it was going to take, and some general target dates. I think what Charlie can probably do is take that and refine that into a timeline where before it was general, month one to month two was going to be this activity. Now put that into a actual calendar year mm-hmm. type of timeline since we've now started this process. There has been some delay with the changeover in staff and wanting to get this process started. So there's been no delay other than that in moving this and allowing Charlie the opportunity to do the research. And then as we get into the thrux of it, there is that basis for the schedule already. So I think Charlie
Even if this is not set in stone, if you have a tentative schedule, can it be put up on the website so that, you know, you could log onto the website and see what's happening even if you're out of town? You would know what subjects are being discussed. And I assume most of the meetings would be televised, so you could link in somehow to see what it is and then send your comments to us.
Absolutely. All of the information will be posted on the website ahead of time, as we had done tonight, the PowerPoint presentation, that give everybody the opportunity to review it so that they can formulate their own questions so that they can be prepared for the presentation material.
As far as the Planning Commission meetings, how busy have your agendas been for your regular meeting?
It varies. Yeah.
Well, this is the second meeting this month so far. Yeah.
Okay, but I mean, on a normal month, do you have time to deal with this issue as part of a regular meeting, or are you foreseeing special meetings to deal with this issue?
It's going to depend on. I think it's month to month.
We need to do whatever it takes to get it done. Yeah. And if it means going to extra meetings, it means going to extra meetings.
We've had a lot of those.
Yeah. Well, we all have a lot of meetings, but if you can't all make them.
I meant planning. We definitely are willing to do it because we've had at least two or three double meetings since the first of the year.
Okay. Would you be willing to hold a special meeting on this topic in, say, late July?
Sure.
Could we schedule that by email?
I can work with you to get that scheduled. The issue with the second meeting this month was because the consultant was not available on the regular meeting, and it was just a timing issue. But as we schedule something out that allows Charlie the opportunity to get it into his schedule and make any appropriate arrangements for any conflicts.
I mean, I think with the amount of public interest on this, it might deserve its own meeting night.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I'd also rather not drive down here for 30 minutes at a regular meeting. I have a personal motivation there, but.
Yeah, I think that's certainly possible. Yeah.
And maybe we can schedule several months out. And if we don't have information for that meeting, we just cancel the meeting. But if you get it on the calendar, and we can work towards that date, then perhaps we can accomplish something.
What I can do is I can work with Jim to find out the meeting room availability, because there are special meetings with the commissioners and other boards and committees. Get together a routine day of the week of the month schedule that's good with the Planning Commission, good with Charlie, and then we can set that forward on a month-to-month basis as to what that day is going to be. And then set that as a meeting schedule. We'll advertise it once for all of those, and then if we need to, we'll cancel one. Then we'll at least have a set schedule that's conducive for everybody.
Makes sense.
That's a way of keeping the process moving. Things work best with monthly meetings. They really do.
Can you also have for your next presentation, assuming you want to go five stories high across all the campuses, what would that what would that be in translate in terms of enrollment? So we have some real hard facts to talk about. I mean, it's kind of vague. Well, if we do five stories in the middle, who would see it, that kind of stuff. But assume you get that kind of growth. How many students would you end up with? So people can kind of get a figure of how big it is. And also to do something that shows that, the financial aspects that the demographics are really there that are requiring growth. Like some real hard facts. Colleges need to grow because there are so many undergraduates coming in the next 10 years. Colleges, if they get this, they can add another 20,000 students here, and that's a great thing for Radnor, or not. Just something a little more than just sort of abstract idea. Assume that whatever you're going to tell us, give me what that would translate into, the number of parking spaces you require, and maximum build out, what you could end up with in student enrollment.
I mean, there are some colleges out there that are having difficulty maintaining their current enrollment. So even though there's potential for a major expansion physically, it's unrealistic to happen market-wise.
Well, I'm just saying if you could give me some data, because according to the SAT people, the demographics are dropping.
Well,
Northeast is decreasing in high school graduates.
What may be more important for that next or first meeting is you can look at the 11 or 12 institutions that we have now, and we could somehow look, maybe the 50,000 square foot level, what can they build today? Because that may be more important, and you may be really shocked one way or the other of what they can build today. Now, what Charlie was talking about is a zoning type thing where you're saying you can put less on the outside but more on the inside. You're going to trade building closer to the neighborhoods for building more in the middle. I don't think he was saying expand it. I think he was saying shift it. So I'm not going to pick on any institution, but somebody can put 10 more buildings up today. I'd like to know that now. And that's one of the things we have on the 10-year plan. But maybe we can get that globally on a chart so we can all understand as a township how much can they build under the current zoning, and then really start to give us direction where we want to go with
Well, I think one thing you need to look at, if we're going to allow five-story buildings, I believe the percentage of building was, what, 30%? There was allowed to be 30% on institutional. If we allow the taller buildings, we need to shrink that percentage. Otherwise...
Your way to level of detail that we don't need to get into tonight. Okay. Just conceptually, I think we should look at what they can build today, and then we can start
But I think conceptually you need to kind of put some numbers to it.
Sure.
You know, that's all I'm trying to ask.
That level of detail could be next to impossible to produce without knowing the exact impervious coverage on each of the campuses, the natural resources, and doing significant typographical resource analysis to determine what exists. We have some ideas to what is out there, but without a detailed topographic survey of each of the parcels, there's no way to determine what the capacity is.
Well, you have that on three of them, because Villanova has come in recently, and they have to produce impervious surfaces on their plans, same way with Eastern and Cabrini. I think the most recent plans we've had from them do list the impervious. So we have an idea of what it can be. And maybe we can use the most recent plans from the various institutions to pick up that number, so at least you'd have a ballpark figure to work from.
But you can also then take impervious over impervious and how that's actually configured out and to sketch that, and one consultant's idea of a sketch could be different from another, and there's a whole different yield analysis that could be done that would just be far outside the scope of what we're looking at. We're looking at a high level of the concepts of what the institutional allows now versus what is beneficial for the township in the future. And getting into those details it's almost a conceptual plan for each of the college campuses of what could happen, what buildings could be removed, what that's not part of the scope, that's too specific at this point.
It would be scary, because I'll tell you, all the build-out studies will tell you that there's this enormous amount of square footage that would be built. But when you look at the individual institutions, in many cases, that green space is part of their marketing. That's part of their character. It's part of their image. I mean, they don't want to cover everything by paving, even if they could. And the market's not there at the tuition they're charging to fill up all that space.
Well, say, go look at Georgetown, and you'll see that they're quite willing to go over all their green space. So that can happen.
The other thing,
turf field, and that's it.
The other thing that I've noticed, I mean, we have in your presentation tonight, and I know it was bantered around a year or so ago, this whole concept of letting them go, of letting universities and institutions go higher, you know, as long as they put it on the interior of the campus and people won't see it and they won't be affected. The reality is, both with Villanova's current proposed plan and a plan that we've seen over the last few months for a parking structure at another institution, universities don't want to put their buildings in the center of their campus. They want their green space in the center where their students can see it and their students can enjoy it and they can create, you know, a green atmosphere within. They want their tall buildings out on the street where we're all seeing them. And so we're not even, I mean, I appreciate, Colleen, I appreciate the numbers you're asking for. I think it's about as impossible as Kevin is saying. But fundamentally, we're at a different crossroad anyway, because the institutions don't want to do the very thing that, you know, our comprehensive plan talked about, and we kind of bantered around this concept of, sure, you can have a taller building and be more creative and put it on the interior campus. They're not doing that. They want green space in the middle. We want the green space around the perimeter so that we have further buffers for our neighborhoods. They don't want to do that. So we have a major... We have kind of a major philosophical hurdle to think about how we want to deal with in terms of that very issue.
I think the institutions want major, dramatic, architectural significant buildings near the entranceway, but not necessarily near the edge. In other words, you drive into Cabrini's campus, you're driving through a wooded area, and then they would want significant buildings when you enter into their core.
We spent 3 months trying to talk to them about putting their parking garage on the interior of their campus where we wouldn't have to see it. And those conversations didn't move forward very much. They wanted to put their tall parking structure on the perimeter of their campus and denude a major piece of woods along Eagle Road. So, I mean, we went back and forth for months. I don't know the status of it right now, but there were several options inside the campus, and they didn't want to do it. I don't know what's going to happen with that.
Susan, the development of the language takes into consideration what we as a township and the community wants to see as the philosophy. If the institution, and once those ordinances are adopted, if the institutions want to develop, they have to develop in accordance with the ordinances. They don't have a choice but to change their philosophy if they want to develop their campuses and if they want to expand, if they want to grow. So, and that's the purpose of doing these meetings and getting this information so that the consultants can put together this language to know what the philosophies are of the township and of the community, and then the institutions are left with dealing and developing in accordance with the codes.
Or petitioning for an overlay.
Which is at the township's discretion whether they want to entertain those or not. So the township has full control over how these campuses are developed once the amendments are put into place.
Well, I do still want to get some sort of number. You could just add two stories to every building now, assume they're students, and give us a number, because the numbers are scary. And they could be 30, 40,000 students in this town. And I think that's something you need to know before you unleash that on people. So I think that should be a number that will be a projection, hard facts of what will happen if you increase building height. Thank you.
Thank you.
I have two questions.
Public comment? Oh. Go ahead.
I have two quick questions. One is, ultimately, this is going to be worked into our ordinance, but in the step and before that, can we have it like clearly identified what we're changing from what we have now to what we're doing, just in, you know, plain English, so that all the public can understand without being familiar with the ordinance, as we go through the process, not yet, but if we're changing something or if it's staying or whatever, just clear bullet points. This is what it is, this is what we're proposing, rather than just having them look at the proposed ordinance.
Yes, we always do a summary. That can be understood by somebody who doesn't understand zoning terminology.
And the other question is, if we do give some relief on a building that's proposed, can they in turn take pieces of land and set them aside as dedicated open space or something that would be permanent?
I think that would be extremely helpful in some of the institutions, is if the institutions would voluntarily say that in return for this flexibility, we will put an easement on this particular piece of land that we will not use it for any buildings or parking. Give the neighbors some comfort level. There might be some time limit on that. They might say for the next 30 or 50 years, we will not use this ball field for any buildings or parking. And then people can feel comfortable that, yes, there might be a larger building in Site A, but that spot in between Site A and their home is going to stay green. And it gives them a little comfort level. We cannot require that. We can ask for it. We cannot contract on a zoning change. We cannot say that we will give you the zoning change if you put an easement on properties A and B. But the neighbors can do that. The neighbors can get an agreement that they won't oppose a zoning change if they get an easement on properties A and B.
I have a question I've been waiting to ask. Somebody mentioned the fact that there are for-profit companies or outside entities that do basically design build for residence halls and so forth, whether it's on the college campus or on adjacent property. In a case like that, would it be possible for us to modify the zoning? I mean, for example, could they put a residence hall, if it's privately owned property, privately owned building, can they put a residence hall in a non-planned institutional use?
The current RADNR requirements require all residence halls, all dormitories, all fraternities, and all sororities to be within the planned institutional district. If you're not in the planned institutional district, you're limited to 2 students anywhere in the township. So you actually have that well covered.
Okay. The next question would be if somebody's operating such a thing as a profit center, why wouldn't the township be able to tax that taxable property? I mean, the function, because it's a private entity, even if it's on institutional real estate.
It's not the township's decision. It's the state's decision. If the state says it's taxable, we can tax it.
But it's a business.
But that's up to the state. Go argue to the state. It's out of our hands. It's not something we control. They are the ones who make that determination.
But if
once they make that determination, then we're allowed to tax it.
But if they have, for example, in the case that he mentioned, a 99-year ground lease and put a building on it or something like that, wouldn't that, in effect, even though it's...
I have no idea. I don't know the formula or the rules and regulations that they use to determine whether or not something is taxable. I don't know. That's why I keep, all these tax issues come up. It's all a state issue. If I could provide the audience with, okay, this is how it works, I would have. I just don't know it. And going back to your earlier question, what you have to keep in mind is zoning doesn't care about who owns the property, who develops the property. It's all about how the property is used. If it's being used as a dormitory, it doesn't matter if that dormitory is for profit, nonprofit, owned by a church, owned by an individual, owned by a foreigner. It doesn't matter. It's the use that is controlling. It's the use that zoning controls. So that's what you have to look at.
Now, is it the ownership of the property which determines whether or not it's tax exempt?
No.
If it's in a planned institutional district, then it's
no, that doesn't matter. It's how the property is being used. You can have the property owned by it's a for-profit corporation, but if it's being used in such a manner that it falls under the rules and regulation to be considered exempt, it's exempt. I think as Jerry mentioned earlier, there's a lot of property that's owned by hospitals, but it's being used as a doctor's office. That's not tax exempt. In Philadelphia, there's tons of property owned by the University of Pennsylvania that is taxed because it's commercial properties. It's retail stores. It doesn't matter if it's being owned by a nonprofit. It's how it's being used.
I think that there's a... you have to up at the mic. But I think that there's a possibility that a situation where a dormitory is converted, if petitioned to the state, could change from a non-tax status to a tax status. But again, we don't have control over that. If it's something that's in question, the township would use our best efforts to make sure that all taxable properties are being taxed.
There is a process, and there is a process that the township can be involved in arguing whether or not it should be granted that status. And in the town, I know Radnor Township has fought, certain applications in the past. But it ultimately, it's up to the it's a state agency that decides that. It's not the township.
Thank you.
I have a question.
Public comments, sir.
My name is Marty Caulfield, and I live on Hawthorne Lane. And the first thing, Charlie, I just want to—I know you're not local, so I wanted to help you out with your research. There is a pedestrian bridge in Radnor Township. We actually paid for it, and it's part of an institution. It's the Radnor Elementary School has one. So you don't have to go look at St. Joe's. We have one. I think it cost over $1 million, and it was probably for all of 40 or 50 parking spaces. So there is one. It's on Matson Ford Road, next to Carol. I was interested. You talked about lighting and how current technology allows it to be focused. When a town changes a planning ordinance, can it be applied retroactively to these institutions? So if they were to adopt a new lighting policy, could it be retroactively applied?
There are some communities that have tried to do that. Your solicitor may be able to do some research on that. Usually, what most solicitors have told us is operational requirements cannot go backwards in time. So if you adopt a new operational zoning requirement, you cannot go back and make previous installations comply.
And what do you mean by operational?
Operational is anything that regulates day-to-day activities, noise, lighting, things that were occurring on a regular basis prior to the ordinance being adopted. Mm-hmm. Now, in reality, often if you adopt a standard and you ask nicely, mm-hmm. lighting is a pretty easy thing to adjust. And communities often can get cooperation on lighting.
Okay. And my last thing is about, we put these ordinances out. How do towns typically enforce them or police them? You talked about the Villanova dormitories having three to a room and using study lounges. If those buildings were not built for that reason, or the occupancy limits are being exceeded, how does a typical town work with a private institution to find out if that's happening?
Well, I imagine the fire inspectors regularly go into all the dormitories. And there's standards on occupancy under the fire codes.
Okay. So was that surprising that when your son had some interest in Villanova University or any of these, any school that they looked at, and you as a professional hear that they have these type of limits exceeded, does that surprise you that a town might not be policing it or governing it?
There's a lot of colleges that have overcrowded dorms.
I realize that, but I'm asking you back to what was your reaction to Radnor Township or the
I'm surprised. I'm surprised Villanova students would pay that much money to live in a triple.
And I apologize, Charlie. I don't think that's my question. My question is, what was your reaction to the town where that university is? Would you have been surprised to say, I can't believe that a town's allowing this exceeding of capacity to occur right underneath their nose?
I didn't think of it in terms of township regulations. I thought of it in terms of livability of a student.
Okay, but maybe now asking the question, are you surprised that a township is allowing this to happen under their nose? So right now, forget about when you had it with your son. Right now, knowing that they have students living in rooms that were not intended to be dorm rooms, having three to a room that was intended to be two, is that a surprise to you?
Charlie, I'm going to ask you not to answer that question. Okay. You haven't researched.
I don't have a reaction. Okay. I don't have an answer.
Okay, very good.
His personal reaction, I don't think, is relevant.
I was actually asking it for his professional. But
you can ask him.
I would like to add to that our fire marshal and our building inspectors are in a lot of the dormitories on a regular basis. Overcrowding does not mean that the buildings are over capacity. They're too big distinct differences between that. If there's an overcapacity issue, we regulate that. An overcrowding and an uncomfortableness for college students isn't something that the building codes regulate.
Kevin Gary, Blackfire Road, a bunch of you brought up 10-year plans, and that got me thinking, how many universities, institutions in this township have updated 10-year plans, and what do you view as an updated 10-year plan? In terms of a shelf life, I mean, I don't expect an institution every day has to put up a new updated 10-year plan or every week, but what is the shelf life how many actually are currently sort of in what you would view as compliance with that?
I think the township has to remind people to comply, mm-hmm. and they've done that in the past. The more often they update it, the better. I think they typically update it when they want to come in for a major project.
Understood. What is that? Is it every year, every 2 years?
It's supposed to be a 10-year plan.
Right, but if I do a 10-year plan in 2008, in 2012, am I still viewed within a 10-year plan? Or is it 2018?
Ideally, they'd update it every 5 years and submit it to the township.
Every 5 years. And how many institutions are currently within that 5-year window? Well, I know one is by a month.
I think all that have brought something to the township in the last 5 years have had to have an update. We won't.
So all the institutions currently within Radnor are within that five-year
window. Anyone who's brought something in front of the committee, because the first thing we ask for is the updated plan.
And then to the commission, what is the process now? This has now obviously been out for public comment. What is the process for giving this to our Board of Commissioners? I'm saddened to see I don't see any of them here. If there is one here, I apologize. And is this something where URDC for township commission meetings is available for public comment? Because as someone said earlier, you basically poked a lot of holes in what is currently going on within our township or about to go on. So what's the process by which this public information is now being shared formally with our township commissioners?
I think, as we said, he's presenting on the 18th.
No,
he's not presenting on the 18th.
Oh, I'm sorry, it's Villanova.
The Villanova proposal is being presented on the 18th. I think what Charlie has done tonight is identified some of the issues with our existing zoning and why there is a need to go through this process. But once we start going through the process and identifying the issues, there's probably going to be meetings with the commissioners as we then develop language. Ultimately, the Planning Commission will make a recommendation on that language. The county will be making a recommendation on that language. It'll be introduced at the commissioners. It'll be offered at a public hearing, and the commissioners then will be adopting it.
But what about this exact presentation? Is there a formal presentation to our township commissioners?
No. Not for this presentation. The general rule is that this is a Planning Commission function. The commissioners delegated this role to the Planning Commission as part of their responsibilities.
I guess I would ask, and I would pay for the 15 cents copy fees, that they all get copies of this.
It's on TV. They can watch it on YouTube and everything else.
Ask your commissioner to watch us.
Yeah. Well, we did, and none of them showed.
No.
No, on TV. They don't have to be here.
They have another four or five chances.
Mr. Geary, to answer your question, 28072B2 says that after the initial submission of a long-range plan, at intervals of two years, they should update it, unless they have or when they submit a land development plan.
So how many institutions are currently not in compliance with that?
I would not be able to answer that for you right now.
I think that's something that should be introduced in the public record of how many institutions are currently not in compliance with Radnor Township law in the 10-year plan.
That they're supposed to describe the current status of their long-range plan at two-year intervals.
There's obviously confusion of what that language means and what 10 years mean. I would ask for you guys to get just clarification for us so we know what an appropriate 10-year plan is.
It may be that they would say that the current 10-year plan is unchanged, and that's the response.
Public email saying that the new 10-year plan has currently changed, because I know one university, as of 1 o'clock today, is now not really part of their 10-year plan. So, thanks.
Thank you. Sir?
My name's Paul McNabb. I live at 28 South Roberts Road, Bryn Mawr, in La Marine Township. Charlie, I had a question. You mentioned dormitories and then also fraternities and sororities. Is that in the current zoning that you're referring to that?
I believe the current zoning does specifically say fraternities and sororities must be in the institutional district. But in any case, even if the words aren't used, other language covers that.
And my question as someone on township staff or the Planning Commission would be, does anyone know whether there are, in Radnor Township, are there any fraternity sorority houses?
There are fraternities and sororities operating out of dormitories in Villanova. What you often get in some colleges is unofficial fraternity houses off campus. I don't know about that.
Well, that's why I asked, because in La Marine Township, right on the other side of County Line Road, at the corner of County Line and Thomas, there's, I believe, a sorority house that operates. So that, and I've made a note to myself to ask in La Marine, because then that raises all kinds of other issues. In La Marine Township, it's three unrelated people can only occupy a house. But
our code can't apply in Lower Marion Township.
I understand that. I understand that. But I just want the clarification, so thank you.
Okay. I thank everybody. We'll move to the next item. Was any additional new business? Any additional old business? Any other final public comment? Seeing none, I'll ask for a motion to adjourn.
Motion to adjourn.
Motion. May I have a second?
Second.
I have a second. All in favor? Aye. Thank you very much. We'll see you in July. Much.